Meg az állásunkra a professzor Zoya Sandic.
Gulam Nabi Azad sir, and distinguished members of the panel and a very distinguished audience. Jawaharlal Nehru's idea of India was based on three tropes: equality. Jawaharlal Nehru's idea of India was based on three tropes: equality, justice, and secularism. And these became the foundation of his government. For him, secularism was a compelling need without which there could be no India. The word secularism, as used by Nehru, was that religion would be excluded from the state. Nehru was clearly committed to the separation of religion and politics and regarded religion as an obstacle in the progress of civilization. Religion, he felt, had absolutely no place in the process of nation building. As he put it in a letter to chief ministers in December 1952, the nation must not be allowed to go astray in the crooked paths of provincialism, communalism, casteism, and all other disruptive and disintegrative tendencies. Nothing could be more relevant today than this quote from Jawaharlal Nehru way back in 1952. However, Indian secularism is quite different from Nehru's ideal and even more different from global secularism or secularism in the West. Indian secular is based on the idea of the coexistence of all religions or equality of all religions. The idea that all religions must be treated equally and must be tolerated in effect means that religion can't be separated from the state, and this has been clearly the central problem with Indian secularism. Nevertheless, secularism has been integral to India's democracy for more than 60 years. In practice, its practice has over the years led to its gradual erosion. That is to say, even the Indian variant of secularism, which is a very diluted version of secularism, its practice over the years has led to its gradual erosion. Secular parties, and I particularly mentioned the Congress here, secular parties, most notably the Congress, has found the idea of scoring quick electoral gains by tampering with secular principles and institutions too tempting to turn down. In the quest for the electoral advantage, the Congress has made in the past a series of choices from the mid-1980s to the mid-1990s that compromised irreversibly India's secular ethos. Despite, or some would say because of the concessions to religious group demands by the Congress, the polity has been driven by competitive communalism and sectarian conflict ever since. The social and political space that the Hindu right seized was created by the retreat of secularism during Congress rule, more crucially by the ambivalence and contradictions in the secular practice. These compromises by the Congress enabled the BJP to discredit the entire secular project, and to that extent one really holds the Congress responsible for what has happened since then. All in all, the secular dispensations, well, and it's not only the Congress, but since this is a meeting organized by the Rajiv Gandhi Institute, it's only appropriate to focus on the role of the Congress. So all in all, secular dispensations, and I mean the Congress here, or more generally, has clearly been under pressure with various quarters. Despite the difficulties into which it has run, secularism, however imperfect, and the Indian secular is clearly imperfect, is not an option. It is an absolute necessity in the context of India's diversity and pluralism. Consequently, India has maintained, at least thus far, we shall see how much further, its commitment to secularism. Secularism has proved in the past to be a principle or a way of ensuring that constitutional guarantees of liberty and equality are fulfilled, and also in situations of communal conflict, which have been plenty in India, it is a way of maintaining harmony. Any weakening of secularism can weaken the resolve of governments and possibly even the judiciaries to protect and extend the rights of the vulnerable and the deprived. of greater danger, and this danger faces us by dismantling actual constitutional provisions and laws that give meaning to those rights, especially the rights of minorities, which is a central feature of Indian secularism, as indeed of secularism everywhere. This would be all the more disturbing as key assurances of the constitution, such as equality before law and fair opportunity, have been breached repeatedly by successive governments, including that of the Congress, and without any redress from the state. And here I would mention just two. The meager implementation of the Satchar Committee recommendations by the Congress when it was in power for, let's say, almost 8 years or 9 years after the Satchar Committee report. The meager implementation of the Satchar Committee recommendations to redress deprivation and disadvantage is a case in point. Secondly, I think the state's discrimination in the administration of the criminal justice system, and this I think should be a matter of great concern. The state, and here clearly there is nothing very much to distinguish the Congress from other governments. That is to say, the state's discrimination in the administration of the criminal justice system is the second issue, which has limited Muslims' access to justice. Now, in the past 18 months, since this government has been in power, the state's lack of neutrality towards religious questions and the concerted movement to impose a communal agenda underline the necessity of secularism, which has lately become a word of abuse. There was, in the past, a loose consensus that the state must not favor any particular religion or community, but the foundational idea of the present ruling party is anti-secular, which has exposed the fragility of this consensus and the fragility of this template. What is a matter of pressing concern, and I say that this with all the emphasis at my command, what is a matter of pressing concern is the lack of a coherent political opposition to these very disturbing developments. In fact, it is the intellectuals who have taken the lead in mounting an opposition to intolerance. Now, it's just as well that political parties are following that, but the fact is that it is really the intellectuals who took the lead in strongly opposing the growth of intolerance in the country. The Congress, after its crushing defeat in the 2014 Lok Sabha elections, was given the impression that perhaps it had placed too much emphasis on secularism and that this had hurt the prospects of the party. By taking this position, I might argue that it is competing with the BJP on its own turf, and this is self-defeating, as the Congress clearly knows from its own experience in the 1990s. Yes, I'll just finish. So we must recognize that supporting secular, and also I think more recently, one gets the sense that Congress can talk about pluralism, tolerance, but is perhaps uncomfortable with too much use of the word secularism, for it fears that might alienate some interests, or perhaps even alienate the majority community. Now, in conclusion then, that we must recognize, however, that supporting secularism or dismissing it is not a matter of political convenience. It's not a political slogan because it is tied to the question of the kind of society that we want. It enables us to think of ourselves primarily as equal citizens of one nation, both in theory and practice. And finally, the dilution of secularism would weaken democracy, since secularism and democracy are not mutually exclusive concepts. Rather, the interconnections between the two in the Indian context are obvious, and this has perhaps been one of the greatest achievements of India's freedom struggle. In today's circumstances, it is perhaps even more important to emphasize the constellation of concepts, which is to say secularism, democracy, equality and justice, and their interconnection. And a serious beginning, I think, has to be made by establishing confidence in a secular society and in the project of secularization of society. So far, we have focused on the state, but I think now, given that state is in the state and the government is in control of a right-wing party, perhaps we can do well to focus on a secular society and the secularization of society. And we can begin by explaining its links to democracy. Thank you.